I'm here to discuss the truth, and yet it occurs to me that I deal in lies. I spend around 7 hours every single day having conversations about lies and falsehoods. I get paid for it. I'm not talking about the many untruths regarding the fate of a misplaced homework. I am, of course, talking about literature. Most literature is imaginary, made up, false. Hamlet, Falstaff, Winston Smith, George and Lenny, Jack and Piggy, the big friendly giant, Matilda, these have never existed. But literature can contain and reveal truths. My Dog Ate My Homework, for instance, reveals a great deal of truth about the speaker. Stories also have this power. Books contain the stories of completely imaginary characters that do completely made up things. Matilda never went to Cruncham Hall, Winston Smith never transgressed a superstate, and Piggy never had his glasses smashed against the beach of a tropical island. These stories reflect things that we all know to be the case. The difficulty of growing up at school, the sad reality of a totalitarian superstate, the miserable consequences of a world without rules. These fictional works reflect the world and allow us to look at it as though we were looking at ourselves and our own world in a mirror. In real life, it's not always easy to see clearly, but the mirror of art allows us to see reality, warts and all. No newspaper article or history book has ever quite had the same impact on me as Orwell's 1984, because Orwell's writing creates a space where we can suspend our idea of truth and believe in Winston Smith's life for the duration of 250 pages or so. The process of trying to mirror the real world is called mimesis. So in Macbeth, for instance, Shakespeare's portrayal of a malign ambition mirrors something true about this base human trait in the real world. By reading Macbeth, rather than simply experiencing this kind of ambition in reality, we can explore the many facets and consequences of such ambition and understand its moral proportions. Real life isn't in five acts, and most of us don't speak in highly evocative blank verse, but Shakespeare's writing elevates and magnifies humanity in the realm of art. He organizes reality in drama. Mimesis is the basis of Western art and literature. Plato is the one who coined the term, although perhaps surprisingly, he loathed poetry and plays because he thought they were merely copies of reality, and therefore were a deceptive and corrupting influence. When building his ideal city-state in the Republic, Plato went as far to ban poetry altogether. But Plato is himself an extremely poetic writer, even writing his ideas in the form of a literary dialogue, using images and symbols to illustrate his philosophical ideas. It could be said that he commits the sin of mimesis. The long history of literature has proved Plato wrong. Art has, for the most part, enriched and advanced human understanding. The question that arises in this century and the last is this: are there limits to what fiction and poetry can explore? Can certain truths not be fashioned in imaginative terms? The most famous case is that of Salman Rushdie, forced into hiding in fear of his life when his novel, The Satanic Verses, was deemed blasphemous and worthy of the punishment of death by the then supreme leader of Iran, the Ayatollah Khomeini. But this book had at least been written and continued to sell in its millions. The subject of the true history of the Quran and whether certain surah were the work of the devil was a subject Rushdie could write about, even if he faced horrendous consequences for his bravery. But can and should all subjects be written about? The great example is that of the Holocaust. The critic and writer Theodore Adorno famously said that there could be no poetry after the Holocaust and that truth would remain in the ashes. This is one of the most contentious statements in all literary criticism. In his book, Prisms, he says, "To write poetry after Auschwitz is barbaric. And this corrodes even the knowledge of why it has become impossible to write poetry today. Critical intelligence cannot be equal to this challenge as long as it confines itself to self-satisfied contemplation. To write poetry after Auschwitz is barbaric. In Adorno's view, the Holocaust created an irreparable chasm in the European mind, a wound that was so destructive that it, in a sense, broke mimesis. To reflect the world in its truly grotesque and evil reality is beyond the powers of what he calls it self-satisfied criticism. In the remainder of this talk, I will argue that this view is short-sighted and invalid. I want to share with you two poems that I think are the greatest proof against Adorno's argument and present deeply disturbing mimetic accounts of perennial suffering. The first poem, Death Fugue, is by Holocaust survivor Paul Celan. The original poem is in German. Death Fugue. Black milk of daybreak, we drink it at sundown. We drink it at noon in the morning, we drink it at night. We drink and we drink it. We dig a grave in the breezes, there one lies unconfined. A man lives in the house, he plays with the serpents, he writes. He writes when dusk falls to Germany, your golden hair, Marguerite. He writes it and steps out of doors and the stars are flashing. He whistles his pack out. He whistles his Jews out in earth, has them dig for a grave. He commands us strike up for the dance. Black milk of daybreak, we drink you at night. We drink you in the morning, at noon, we drink you at sundown. We drink and we drink you. A man lives in the house, he plays with the serpents, he writes when dusk falls to Germany, your golden hair, Marguerite, your ashen hair, Shulamith, we dig a grave in the breezes, there one lies, unconfined. He calls out, jab deeper into the earth, you lot, you others sing now and play. He grabs at the iron in his belt, he waves it, his eyes are blue, jab deeper, you lot, with your spades, and you others play on for the dance. Black milk of daybreak, we drink you at night. We drink you at noon in the morning, we drink you at sundown. We drink and we drink you. A man lives in the house, your golden hair, Marguerite. Your ashen hair, Shulamith, he plays with the serpents. He calls out more sweetly, play death, death. Is a master from Germany. He calls out more darkly now, stroke your strings, then as smoke you will rise into air. Then a grave you will have in the clouds, there one lies, unconfined. Black milk of daybreak, we drink you at night, we drink you at noon. Death is a master from Germany. We drink you at sundown, and in the morning we drink and we drink you. Death is a master from Germany. His eyes are blue. He strikes you with leaden bullets. His aim is true. A man lives in the house. Your golden hair, Marguerite. He sets his pack onto us. He grants us a grave in the air. He plays with the serpents and daydreams. Death is a master from Germany. Your golden hair, Marguerite. Your ashen hair, Shulamith. This is poetry of the first order. It is an incantatory, dreamlike series of impressions. Celan has abandoned any effort to produce an easy narrative. The repetitions and thunderous prophetic visions culminate until we are left with a simple and haunting juxtaposition between the golden hair of Marguerite and the ashen hair of Shulamith. Many of its images are self-annihilating paradoxes. Black milk, the temporal confusion of sundown and daybreak, the haunting impossibility of digging a grave in the breezes, which captures the inability to dignify the deaths of 6 million, instead having to settle for a grave of ash in the air as the bodies were incinerated. It's a perplexing poem because it is unlike anything else we have read. Celan himself said, "Only one thing remained reachable, close and secure amid all losses. Language." Yes, language. In spite of everything, it remained secure against loss, but it had to go through its own lack of answers, through terrifying silence, through the thousand darknesses of murderous speech. It went through. It gave me no words for what was happening, but went through. Went through and could resurface, enriched by it all. The poem certainly is not self-satisfied, criticism as Adorno would have it, but a reflection of a deeper personal truth, a mimetic reckoning with the scar of the Shoah, which destroyed his parents' lives and perhaps drove him to commit suicide in Paris in 1970. The second great poem to challenge Adorno's dictum is by an English poet who has only recently passed away. Geoffrey Hill, a poet interested in history and remembrance, who gained a reputation for being difficult. This poem is called September Song. September Song. Born 19th of the 6th, 32, deported 24th of the 9th, 42. Undesirable you may have been, untouchable you were not, not forgotten, or passed over at the proper time. As estimated, you died. Things marched sufficient to that end. Just so much cyclone and leather, patented terror, so many routine cries. I've made an elegy for myself. It is true. September fattens on vines. Roses flake from the wall. The smoke of harmless fires drift to my eyes. This is plenty. This is more than enough. One of Hill's shortest poems, it gains its power from what it avoids saying. The poet seems to break down at the end of this lyric, unable to continue rendering poetry from the subject, very much playing into Adorno's hands. But by saying this is more than enough, Hill has written a poem about the unspeakable nature of his subject, and in a way, has had his cake and eaten it. The strange interjection in brackets, I have made an elegy for myself, it is true, speaks to Adorno directly. He admits to the poem being as much about himself and his own reckoning with Europe's past as the undesirable victim. It is his elegy rather than an elegy of the little 10-year-old girl being described. I read Hill's poem as an admittance of the subjective nature of poetry and also a celebration of it. His subject is his figuring out what the suffering of the Holocaust was all about. It was routine. The bureaucratic words ripple through the poem. Estimated, passed over, proper time. The poet is disturbed by the ruthless efficiency, the trademark, the patented terror of Nazi death squads. He turns away from trying to describe the girl and her Holocaust experience directly to this beautiful and moving stanza. September fattens on vines. Roses flake from the wall. The smoke of harmless fires drifts to my eyes. Harmless fires, because the fires burn not the living, but the already dead. The Holocaust as a subject is the hardest one to broach, but I contend that it is a legitimate subject for literature, and also that it deserves a literature. These two poems represent the summit of Holocaust poetry so far, both mimetically exploring the subject indirectly and making the very difficulty of expressing ideas about such a delicate subject part of the thematic fabric of their work. I suppose Adorno's great error is his equating criticism and art. After all, we are all agreed that self-satisfied criticism is out of place when attempting to understand Auschwitz, but poetry and art are more than criticism, and more than mere facts. They can contain truth even about the Holocaust. It's a different kind of truth that we see in these two poems, a ceaseless circling, a kind of trepidation in the verse. The words subscribe to subconscious truth, dealing in impressions, fueled by anxieties in expression itself. These intellectual and emotional tumults have been contained in poetry for posterity. They will give a gift of truth, like all great literature, to those who attempt discovery, which cannot be gained by other means.